Welcome to VLearn's online class. In today's session, we will discuss about input-output systems. And the topics to be covered under this session are input-output devices or external or peripheral devices, input-output interface, device controllers, the structure of device controllers, device drivers, input-output technique, input-output processors, and external communication interfaces. First of all, what is input and output device, or what is external or peripheral device? If we talk about a typical microcomputer, then it consists of a microprocessor, memory and input-output interface, and the different components that form the systems are linked through the buses that transfer the data, instructions, addresses and control signals among these components. And the microcomputer has a single microprocessor and a number of RAM and ROM chips and interface units that communicate with the various external devices through the input-output bus. You can see the block diagram of microcomputer in which various devices are connected, like keyboard, display device, mouse, digital camera are connected to the local bus by various input-output buses or various control units, like LAN, printer, Ethernet, modem are connected to the local bus by using the LAN network. CD-ROM, printer and scanner are connected to the local bus by using CSI. Keyboard, mouse, FDD are connected to the local bus by using EISA to the local bus. The input-output subsystem of a computer provides an efficient mode of communication between the central system and the output environment. And the input-output devices are attached to the computer are also known as peripherals, which are divided into different categories like human-readable, machine-readable and communication. Human-readable means that are suitable for communicating with the computer user, for example, video display terminals like VDTs and printers. Machine-readable means the devices which are suitable for communicating with equipments, for example, magnetic disk and tape systems. And communication that is suitable for communicating with remote devices, for example, terminals and a machine-readable devices. The next topic is input-output interface. The input-output interface provides a method for transferring the information between the internal storage and external input and output devices. And all the peripherals are connected to the computer needs a special communication link for interfacing with the CPU. And the purpose of the communication link is to resolve the differences that exist between the central computer and each peripheral. There are different types of differences that exist between the central computer and peripherals. Some of the important differences are, peripherals are mainly electromagnetic or electromechanical devices, whereas if we talk about the CPU or the processor, then it is electronic device. Then the data transfer rate of peripherals is usually slower than the data transfer rate of the CPU. So, consequently, synchronization mechanism may be needed here. Data codes and formats in peripherals differ from the word format in the CPU and the memory. The operating mode of peripherals are different from each other, and each must be controlled so as not to disturb the operation of other peripherals connected to the CPU. And to resolve this type of differences, the computer system includes special hardware component between the CPU and peripheral that supervise and synchronize all the input and output transfers. And these components are called interface units because they interface between the processor bus and the peripheral devices. Now, if we talk about the functions of input-output interface, as I already discussed with you, that the main purpose of input-output interface is to resolve the various differences that exist between the processor, central computer, or each peripheral. So, an input-output interface is a bridge between the processor and input-output devices. It controls the data exchange between the external devices and the main memory or external devices and the processor registers. Therefore, the major functions of an input-output interface are, firstly, it should be able to provide control and timing signals because the need of input-output from various input-output devices by the processor is quite unpredictable, and in fact it depends on the input-output needs of particular programs and normally does not follow any pattern. Since input-output device also shares a system bus and memory for the data input-output, so control and timings are needed to coordinate the flow from or to external devices or to and from processor or memory. Then it should be able to communicate with the processor. Then it should communicate with the input-output device because communication between input-output interface and input-output device is needed to complete the input-output operation, and this communication involves commands and status or data. Then it should have a provision for data buffering. Data buffering is very useful for the purpose of smoothing the gaps in speed of the processor and input-output devices. The data buffer are mainly registers which hold the input-output information temporarily. Then error detection mechanism should be inbuilt. The error detection mechanism involves checking the mechanical as well as data communication errors, and these errors should be reported to the processor. After the input-output interface, the next one is device controllers and the structure of device controller. A device controller is an interface between the input-output device and the system bus. Device controller, at the name, already depicts that it controls a particular device. It knows how to communicate with the input-output device that is connected to it. It knows how to communicate with the computer CPU or processor and memory through the system bus. Now, device controller need not necessarily control a single device but can control multiple devices also. And it comes in the form of an electronic circuit board that plugs directly into the system bus, and there is a cable from the controller to each device it controls. Now, there are various advantages of device controllers. It allows multiple input-output devices to connect to the system. Input-output devices can easily be changed without the change in the computer system, and it provides flexibility to buy in the different input-output devices from different vendors. You can see the device controllers image that connect various input-output devices. Device controller hold input-output port through which various input-output devices are connected to it. And these device controllers are further connected to the bus and to the main memory and CPU by this bus. If we talk about the structure of the device controller, then each input-output device is linked through the hardware interface called input-output port. Then, single or multi-port devices control single or multi-devices. The communication between the input-output controller and memory is through mainly bus, only in case of DMA. Whereas, the path through the CPU for such communication in case of non-DMA means if there is direct memory access, then the communication between input-output controller and memory is through bus only. And if it is non-DMA, then the path passes through the CPU for such communications. Next one is the structure of input-output interface. The general structure of input-output interface contains control lines between the processors, input-output interface for input-output logic which interprets and execute dialogues between the processor and input-output interface, data line connecting input-output interface to the system bus must exist. Data registers that act as buffer between the processor and input-output interface, and input-output interface contains logic specific to the interface with each device that it controls. This is all about the structure of input-output interface. The next one is device driver. A device driver is a computer program that operates or controls a particular type of device that is attached to the computer, and the driver provides a software interface to hardware devices, enabling operating system and other computer programs to access hardware functions without needing to know precise details of the hardware being used. The device driver is a software interface which manages the communication with and the control of a specific input-output device or types of devices. It is the task of the device driver to convert the logical request from the user into specific commands directed to the device itself. A driver communicates with the device through the computer bus or communications subsystem to which the hardware connects, and when a calling program invokes a routine in a driver, then a driver issues command to the device, and once the device sends data back to the driver may invoke routines in the original calling program. So drivers are hardware dependent and operating system specific. They usually provide the interrupt handling required for any necessary asynchronous time dependent hardware interfaces. Now there are various device drivers according to the operating system. For example, device drivers in Unix, MS-DOS and Windows subsystem. If we talk about the Unix, in Unix the device drivers are usually linked on the object code of the kernel. The advantages of Unix device drivers are runtime efficiency and simplicity is the advantage of Unix device drivers. And disadvantages, addition of a new device requires regeneration of the kernel. In MS-DOS, device drivers are installed and loaded dynamically, they are loaded into the memory when the computer is started and rebooted and accessed by the operating system as required. And the advantage of this is it makes addition of a new driver much simpler, so it could be done by relatively unskilled users. If we talk about the Windows system, then the device drivers are implemented as dynamic link libraries, and this technique has advantage that DLL contains shareable code, which means that only one copy of the code needs to be loaded in the memory. Secondly, a driver for a new device can be implemented by the software or hardware vendor without the need to modify or affect the Windows code. The next topic is input-output techniques. There are three input-output techniques, that is programmed input-output, interrupt-initiated input-output and direct memory access. In programmed input-output, no interrupt is required and the input-output interface to and from memory transfer is done through the CPU. Similarly, in interrupt-driven input-output, interrupt signal is required and the input-output interface to or from memory transfer is done through the CPU. But if we talk about the DMA, that is direct memory access, in direct memory access the interrupt is required but input-output interfaces to and from memory transfer is direct to the memory. First of all, programmed input-output. It is a useful input-output method for computers where hardware cost needs to be minimized. In programmed input-output, the input-output operations are completely controlled by the processor. The processor executes a program that initiates, directs and terminates the input-output operation. It requires a little special input-output hardware but is quite time-consuming for the processor since the processor has to wait for slower input-output operations to complete. In programmed input-output, the input-output commands can be control, test, read and write. Control are used to specific instructions to give specific instructions to the device. Test is used to check the status if device is ready or not. Read to input that of data from input device and write to output of data to the output device. Next is input output instructions. An input output instruction means the set of tasks which are stored in the memory of the computer and is fetched and executed by the processor, producing an input output related commands for the input output interface. In the systems with programmed input output, the input output interface, the main memory and the processor normally shares a system bus. The input-output interface should interpret the address lines to determine if the command is for itself. There are two methods that can be memory mapped and isolated input-output method. In memory mapped, there is single address space of memory location and input-output devices, and for memory mapped input-output, only a single read and single write line are needed for the memory or input-output interface read and write operations. If we talk about the isolated input-output, there are separate control lines for both memory and input-output device read and write operations. The input-output devices and memory are addressed separately, hence separate input and output instructions are needed which cause data transfer between addressed input-output interface and processor. But there are few problems that are associated with the programmed input-output. That is, the processor has to wait a long time for the input-output interface to see whether a device is free or wait till the completion of input and output operation. The result is that the performance of the processor goes down tremendously. So, next input-output technique, that is interrupt-driven input-output, is implemented. The problem with the programmed input-output, that is the processor has to wait for a long time or for the input-output interface to see whether a device is free or wait till the completion of input-output, which results the performance of the processor goes down tremendously. And For the solution of this problem, the next technique, that is interrupt driver input output technique mechanism, is used. In interrupt driver input output mechanism, for transferring a block of data, different technique is used. If we talk about the problem, then solution of the problem associated with the programmed input output, then what is the solution? What about the processor going back to do other useful work without waiting for the input output device to complete or get freed up? But how will the processor be intimated about the completion of any input output, or the device is ready for input output, etc.? A well-designed mechanism for this is adopted, which is referred to as interrupt-driven input-output. And in interrupt-driven input-output, the provision of interruption of processor work once the device has finished the input-output or when it is ready for the input-output has been provided. Means whenever the device has finished any input-output or when it is ready for any input-output, then it will provide an interrupt signal to intimate about its status. After taking the required action with the data, the CPU can go back to the program it was executing before the interrupt. And after issuing the read command, the CPU goes off to do other useful work while input-output interface proceeds to read data from the associated device. On the completion of the instruction cycle, the CPU checks for the interrupts, and after taking the required action with the data, the CPU can go back to the program it was executing before the interrupt. If we talk about the interrupt processing, then the occurrence of interrupt fires a number of events both in the processor hardware or software. When any input-output device completes its input or output operations, then some sequence of hardware event occurs. That are, the device issues an interrupt signal to the processor, the processor finish execution of the current instruction before responding to the interrupt. Means firstly interrupt signal is issued to the processor. When the processor receives the interrupt signal, then it will finish the execution of the current instruction before responding to the interrupt. The processor then test for the interrupt and send the acknowledgement signal to the device that issued that particular interrupt. The minimum information required to be stored for the task being currently executed before the CPU starts executing the interrupt routine R means the minimum information required to be stored for the task being currently executed before the CPU starts executing the interrupt routine R, the status of the processor, which is contained in the register called process program status world, and the location of the next instruction to be executed of the currently executing program, which is contained in the program counter. Next, the process now loads the PC with the entry location of the interrupt handling program, which will respond to the interrupting condition. The program counter and program status world relating to the interrupt program have already been saved in the system stack. The interrupt handler next processes the interrupt, and when interrupt processing is complete, the saved register values are retrieved from the stack and restored to the register. And the final step of the interrupt processing is to restore the values of the PSW and PC from the stack. There are various design issues in interrupt driven input output. The main two issues are, how does the processor determine which device issues the interrupt, and if at the same time multiple interrupts are occur, then how does the processor decide which one to be processed first? And there are various techniques to solve these design issues, like multiple interrupt lines, software pool, daisy chain, and bus arbitration. In multiple interrupt line, it is the simplest solution to the problem. That is, to provide multiple interrupt line, which will result in immediate recognition of the interrupting device. And priorities can be assigned to various interrupts, and the interrupt with the highest priority should be selected for the service in case of multiple interrupt occurs. Next one is software poll. In this game, on occurrence of an interrupt, the processor jumps to an interrupt service program and routine whose job is to poll each input-output interface to determine which input-output interface has caused interrupt. And this may be achieved by reading the status register of the input-output interface. Next one is daisy chain. It is also known as hardware poll. With this technique, an interrupt acknowledge line is changed through various interrupt devices. All the input-output interfaces share a common interrupt request line, and when the processor senses an interrupt, it sends out an interrupt acknowledgement, and this signal passes through all the input-output devices until it gets to the requesting device. The first device which has made the interrupt request thus senses the signal and responds by putting in the word which is normally an address of the interrupt service program. And the last technique is bus arbitration. In this scheme, an input-output interface first needs to control the bus, and only after that it can request for an interrupt. And in this scheme, since only one of the interface can control the bus, therefore only one request can be made at a time. The third technique of input-output is DMA, that is direct memory access. As we have already discussed about the interrupt driver and programmed input-output, in which the processor is busy with executing input-output instruction, and input-output transfer rate is limited by the speed with which the processor can test and service a device. And these advantages can be overcome with the help of DMA, which act as if it has taken over control from the processor. It is the input-output devices. In DMA, the input-output devices access the memory directly through the system bus. A technique called cycle stealing allows the DMA interface to transfer one data at a time, after which it must return control of the bus to the processor. The DMA interface transfers the entire block of data, one word at a time, directly to or from the memory without going to the processor. And when the transfer is complete, the DMA interface sends an interrupt signal to the processor. So, DMA is a feature of computerized systems that allows certain hardware subsystems to access main memory or main system memory independently of the central processing unit. And without DMA, the CPU is using the programmed input-output. It is typically fully occupied for the entire duration of the read and write operations, and thus unavailable to perform the other tasks. And with DMA, the CPU first initiates the transfer, then it goes other operations while the transfer is in progress, and it finally receives an interrupt from the DMA controller when the operation is done. This feature is useful at time that the CPU cannot keep up with the rate of data transfer, or when the CPU needs to perform useful work while waiting for a relatively slow input-output data transfer. Many hardware systems use DMA, including disk drive controllers, graphic cards, network cards, sound cards, etc. It is also used for intra-chip data transfer in multi-core processor. DMA can also be used for memory-to-memory copying or moving of data within memory. The DMA controller can generate memory addresses and initiates memory read and write cycles. It contains several processor registers that can be read or written by the CPU. The DMA transfer can either occur one byte at a time or all at once in burst mode. If they occur at a byte at a time, then this can allow the CPU to access memory on alternate bus cycles. This is called cycle stealing, since the DMA controller and CPU contend for the memory access. And if we talk about the burst mode DMA, then the CPU can be put on hold while the DMA transfer occurs, and a full block of possibly 100 or thousands of bytes can be moved. This is all about the DMA, that is direct memory access, in which CPU intervention is not required to transfer data between the input output and memory.